Divine Truth documentary. Jesus, Mary and others provide information to people or organizations that produce documentaries. In this video, Mary is interviewed by Thomas Litter while staying with Thomas and his cameraman Simon. This is session 7, filmed on the 14th of August 2013 in Mooloolabah, Queensland, Australia.
So can you tell me about your life in the spirit world?
Yeah. So my memories of the spirit world are sometimes even more painful perhaps than talking about my life on earth in the first century, and that's because it was a very happy time for me in living in the spirit world. Jesus and I did a lot of things together where we were teaching people truths about God and about the universe, very similar to what we attempt to do now and what we did in the first century. But in the spirit world, things are really lovely in that as you bring yourself more and more in harmony with love, your environment reflects that. And so there's more freedoms, there's more beauty, and you attract people who have similar interests, who are in the same condition of love. On earth, everyone mixes in together. You know, there can be someone who's really quite developed in love with someone who maybe hasn't developed in love yet. They've had a harder life and they haven't understood how to grow in love, and so they're often a lot more unloving to themselves, to their environment, to others. And those two people can be in the same shopping centre or sat next to each other on a bus or mixed together often. And that creates changes in the environment on earth. Sometimes it feels pleasant in nature or in a nice environment, but then sometimes we see very dark things happening on the planet, like wars and people in poverty and hunger. In the spirit world, those kinds of things don't happen as you grow in love. As you grow in love, there's a limitation placed on someone who might harm the environment or who might harm others. So once you work through all of the emotions that might cause you to harm another person or harm your environment or harm yourself, you go into a different sphere or realm or a different location that means that those people who haven't yet learned that lesson in love can't be there with you. And this continues because there's many, many lessons of love that we all need to learn as we grow towards God. And there's a continual progression. So in the spirit world, as you grow in love, you begin to have a life that reflects that love in your relationships, in the environment, and it's very beautiful. But often, because I feel now that I've lost that development, that I've lost that lovely home and lovely locations and lovely friends, thinking about the spirit world sometimes makes me quite sad. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah, because also I guess a sense of loss in the sense that you said that you had two other children, right? And where are they then?
Well, in the spirit world, yeah. So I've had three children and two of them are still in the spirit world. And Sarah, my third child, was also in the spirit world with me while I was there. So I got to have a good relationship with them while we were in the spirit world. But they have their own soulmates and their own interests as well. So we didn't necessarily live together as a family might live together on earth. All of the relationships that are based on love in the spirit world are not bound necessarily by family. They're bound by common passions, common desires, and also the way God's designed our soul is that our perfect playmate or workmate or co-adventurer is our soulmate. And that's the person, which is a beautiful gift really that God's given us, that there's another person who's, when they are living in harmony with love and in harmony with their personality, they so much match our own that we find it really fun and enjoyable and a growth experience to do things together. So most of the time in the spirit world I spent with my soulmate, but I did have the great opportunity to spend time with my kids. And Sarah, our daughter, has very common passions to ourselves, as do the boys do to some extent, but not quite as much.
So have you met up with Sarah on Earth again?
No. I've spoken with her on the phone and had some email contact with her, but Sarah's in the place which I have been in the past, which is feeling very afraid of her memories, feeling very afraid of what it means to be someone who's back on Earth, who's had a long life beforehand, and she very much wants to just be who she was born as now, and sort of avoid that part of her personality, which I personally understand, because it's very psychologically jarring to feel that you're someone reincarnated, for want of a better word, not in the perhaps sense that most people on Earth would understand that word, but someone who's had a long life in the spirit world and has decided to return to Earth. That is a very strange thing to come to terms with, and it invokes what has done for me, and I know it does for her and any others of the 14 as well. We all experience a great deal of fear, psychological stress about it, and it's not exactly a welcome realization when it happens. And I probably don't want to speak too much about her, because I know that she wants her privacy. She doesn't really want to be associated with us, even, because she feels that she actually wants to feel that it's not true. Even though she's experienced quite a lot of memories and been through a period of feeling that it is true, she feels quite afraid at the moment about it all.
So does she live in Australia?
No.
Is that difficult for you though?
In the past it probably was, but not for any loving reason within myself. When I was coming to terms with all of with who I am, and when I was beginning to allow more memories and more emotions that brought more memories, I felt very needy to see her. I wanted to feel reassured that she was going through the same thing that I was going through, and I also wanted to avoid a lot of my sadness about not having her and feeling that I'd lost her. As I've allowed those emotions more, I feel like I really honour her will to do what she wants with her life, and I love her, and I don't actually need to see her to love her. I feel that it's important that she has her own life and does what she wants to do with it, and any kind of projection I might have at her that I need her to be with me, or that she should, or that I miss her, or that I feel all of those things were based around selfish emotions inside of myself. The more humble I am, the less I feel those things.
And did you communicate with people in the spirit world, maybe friends or...?
Sure. I'm a medium and I speak with spirits, or I communicate with spirits is probably a better way of putting it. And yeah, I have a spirit guide who was on Earth with us in the first century. Two spirit guides actually, Rachel and her soulmate Tim. And I speak to other people who are around, people who might need help, who find themselves in situations of darkness in the spirit world just after they've passed, or some of them have been in the spirit world for a long time searching for answers. And sometimes they come to us, and well, oftentimes they come to us and ask for assistance.
So from what age were you? Did you find out you were a medium?
Well, I've always been a medium, but it's probably only in the last 6 years. Well, it is only in the last 6 years that I've understood that I was channeling spirits and that I could speak to spirits. I always had... I was very afraid of spirits, or the idea of spirits before then. And so even though I often had flashes of deep inspiration, I was often told that I was wise beyond my years, which perhaps has a different... and there might be a different rationale for that also now that I know who I am. But I would write beautiful poetry, and often I was channeling spirits. I could... and often when I was in a pub or I was drinking, I could sense a lot of things that were going on, and I didn't really understand what I was sensing. and I would sometimes be influenced by spirits. And I know that because I had a certain experience or a certain set of sensations that now that I'm more conscious of being a medium, I understand as other people's feelings and emotions. And it's sort of as if I always had a gift, and it's only recently that I understood how to use that gift positively and consciously.
Can you give me an example maybe of the, you know, that young boy Thomas example where you channeled?
Sure. There's many examples I could probably give you about the experience of channeling, but one night we did some channeling with some, actually it was with a friend of ours, Peter, who's also a medium. We had an evening where we were just decided we would like to help some spirits, and he started doing the channeling. He had a group of Polish people who came to him who had passed during the Holocaust. And we spoke to these women and men. It was men initially for a while, and then some women came who were very angry, and I channeled them for a time. And then a young boy came to me who was, his name was Thomas, like yourself, and he was really stuck in this place where he was very drawn to the emotions of his parents. He had passed during the Holocaust with his parents. And because they were in a lot of pain and rage about the injustice of what had happened to them, and they wanted their son to be with them, he remained with them for a long time. And we just helped him see that he could actually move from this place that was quite dark and sad and lonely and start to have his own experience, that he could still come back and visit his parents and even help them
and some people
with their situation. Yes. We helped them quite a bit with their situation. But that he could begin to have his own life and his own experience in the spirit world. And that was a really lovely experience. It's lovely to speak with children or people who have passed as children, because often they maintain a sense of openness or innocence, what we would call innocence, in terms of being willing to ask questions and experiment with things. Whereas some people who pass as adults, they've already absorbed quite a lot of fear from their environment on Earth, and so they pass in a great state of fear. And when we're really afraid, it makes us, and we're living in that fear, we're not willing to challenge that fear, it makes us less open to taking chances or trying experiments or taking opportunities. So it was lovely speaking with Thomas.
Do you have another example?
Sure. What's another one? Jesus and I spoke to, on Christmas Day last year, I think it was, we spoke to a group of atheists who came to us. People who were atheists on Earth and who passed into the spirit world, still believing that there's no such thing as God, and that the mind is the most important tool that we have to understand our experience and with which to develop our ethics and morality. And they came to us because they could see that even though we were developed and continue to be developing in ethics and morality and love for our fellow human beings, they could see that we weren't using our mind to do that, and also that we had a belief in God. And they said that they hadn't always observed this in others, people on Earth, and they wanted to speak to us about it. So we had a great discussion with them, talking to them about how it's possible to open your heart and allow your emotions in a relationship with God to guide, to heal you and guide you towards more ethics, love and morality, and that you don't, and actually relying on your mind is a much slower process. So that was a fascinating talk.
Thank you. You want to say?
Yeah, I'm good, but you're okay.
Yeah. I could just, this is just developing more and more and more. It's, trying to hone it down a little bit. Because yesterday you explained to me about the horrific way in which you died.
Yeah.
Could you explain to me a little bit about that, and then how you managed to, what do you say, how you managed to deal with those emotions? Because I guess you had to deal with those emotions in the spirit world.
Yeah. The strange thing about being back here now is that we have these memories of these horrific things that have happened on in our first century lives. And by coming back here, we've actually lost the condition of love that we had when we were in the spirit world. And so we reincarnate, if you like, we enter our mother's womb with this bunch of memories, and those memories are then affected by the fears and anger and any issues of unlovingness that are inside our parents. So my parents that conceived me 35 years ago, their emotions really impacted on how I now recall my first century passing and my first century death. So when I passed, that's a little bit of context that is perhaps not necessary.
It is.
Anyway, in the first century, my passing was very traumatic. There was a lot of violence involved, and I had some level of like terror, fear, grief, horror. And so when I say some level, it was quite a lot. But prior to the time when I was captured and tortured, I had been developing my relationship with God quite a lot. So the love that I could reflect and the fear that I had let go of was even more advanced than I'm reflecting now, or far more advanced than what I reflect now. So while my death was very painful and traumatic, and I needed to spend some time immediately after my passing in the first sphere of the spirit world, just releasing the grief and the terror and the horror of it. And I did that through sobbing and shaking and just allowing myself to be overwhelmed with the sensations that were being shut down in me while other people were controlling and manipulating my body. And once I did that, then I was able to, I came to a sense of peace about what had happened, and I was able to move on and look forward in my life. But while I was retaining that terrible, horrible set of events inside of me emotionally and suppressing those emotions, I really couldn't shift forward. So I had to allow them to overwhelm me and just be released from me. That happened fairly quickly, within a number of weeks of what we would call weeks on in Earth time. Time is a little bit different in the spirit world, but I was able to process through that quite quickly. And I had assistance, my soulmate was with me, and once I did that, then I was able to be in a much higher sphere, much higher, because I had a lot of love already, I'd received a lot of God's love already, and it was just this trauma that was keeping me in a lower place.
So, because no one has come back to Earth before, is there any worry about what may happen when you pass, as you say, for the second time?
Do you mean, am I afraid of being harmed again?
Not necessarily afraid of being harmed, but you... or returning to the spirit world?
No. I don't feel any fear about returning to the spirit world. In fact, sometimes I have a feeling that I'd like to. Not in any kind of macabre sense, just that it's a lovely place. It's a really lovely place. And God's designed everything in our existence, even here on Earth. But it's especially noticeable in the spirit world that everything is designed around love. And so, to me, the spirit world holds no fear whatsoever for me, because I know that if I desire love, if I desire to grow, if I'm humble to whatever my experience is there, help will come, rewards will come, love will come, and everything will continue to improve. So I don't have any fear about returning there.
Was it hard to come to terms with who you are?
Most definitely. I feel in a lot of ways I'm still coming to terms with who I am. By that I mean that I had a lot of experiences in my life prior to meeting AJ that I couldn't understand, that I didn't have an answer for. I had emotional experiences that were memories, actually, and I had no idea what was really going on. And I didn't even really try to resolve it. In fact, I really tried to suppress the whole experience. Meeting him was sort of a catalyst for me beginning to understand a lot more things. But it didn't happen just rapidly. I didn't just meet him and say, oh, well, that explains all of that, and great, I'm Mary Magdalene. In fact, I went through a lot of rebellion about that concept even. I was happy to find God's truth again. I met him, I heard it, and it was like I'd always known it. But I was very unhappy with this idea that the reason that was such a natural thing for me was because I was Mary Magdalene. I wanted any other answer, and I searched, I shopped for other answers, I read books, I looked at, you know, is it possible that I have a mental illness? Is it possible that somehow I've created this experience because I have a deep underlying desire to be special or have attention? I really looked at that, and I think that was fairly easy to resolve because I was pretty much hiding from everyone and hiding this experience from everyone for a number of years after we met. And I was very shy of cameras. I didn't want to talk to anyone about what I felt, what I knew. And there was all, at the same time, there's all these psychological issues that arise of like, well, if I'm Mary Magdalene, then who's Mary Luck? And honestly, I could probably talk to you for hours about the kind of psychological issues that come up, the fears. There was a lot of anger in me as well that I needed to come to terms with this in order to be myself. Because the more I have opened up to being myself, the more this experience is confirmed for me. But getting back to your question, which was how do you come to terms with it, or how have I come to terms with it? I feel that there's still parts of it that I'm coming to terms with it about, in that yes, I'm Mary Magdalene, but that also means that I'm going to be teaching divine truth on earth for the rest of my life, and people such as yourself are going to come and talk to me about that, and I still find that challenging at times. I still fear the attention, I suppose, and I feel that there's far more interesting people out there than me, and I just love talking to people about God and God's truth and the beautiful potentials of our life when we have a relationship with God. But in terms of coming to terms with the magnitude of what it means to tell the rest of the world very openly and plainly, I'm Mary Magdalene, there's only one of me, and I am here, I have come back, that's still something that I'm coming to terms with.
So can you understand public opinion, where they might think, she's got to be nuts?
Yeah, I mean, I feel most people think that I'm nuts. And that's been a lot of my fear. I didn't want everyone to think about me for the rest of my life that I'm a nutter. That felt very sad even for me. I felt like, wow, everyone's going to have a preconceived notion of why I might be saying this or what it's all about before they even meet me. And even the people who I knew before, I mean, I think most of them think I've gone a bit nuts. I've resolved the fact that I'm not nuts, but I very much wanted people's approval most of my life, and coming to grips with the fact that from now on most people will think I'm nuts, until perhaps they start to see that what we're teaching is not so nuts, and that we're actually growing and changing and starting to reflect God's love more and more, perhaps then people might take more pause about it. But at this point, I understand that people think I'm nuts, and I also know that there's been a lot of people on earth before who've said that they're Jesus, who've said that they're Mary Magdalene, who've said that they're a reincarnation of, I don't know, an Egyptian pharaoh, or all kinds of things, who at times have not made much sense and have perhaps not had such loving principles or ideals in their life, and that to some degree has coloured how people see our claims.
Because in the car we mentioned yesterday that there are four options of
either we're crazy, I mean insane, that we believe that we're these people, and but we're actually not in touch with reality. That we're actually lying to people. We're conscious. This is the other option, that we're consciously lying to people, that we know that we're not Jesus and Mary Magdalene, but we just want to deceive others. There's a third option, that we're just having a go. We think it's a bit of a laugh and we're just seeing how far we can take things and having a joke on others. And the fourth option, I suppose, is that we are who we're saying. Now, as I think I've mentioned to you before, most people who come to our seminars for any length of time consider those four options, right? Are these guys crazy? Are they deceiving us? Are they having a joke, or are they for real? And most people go, well, I know it's not one, I know it's not two, I know it's not three, but it can't be four either. And so often people are in this place of, you know, unresolved feelings about us.
Mm-hmm. I've only touched this briefly and I haven't spoken to AJ about this yet, but I've read about the predictions, the short term predictions actually, about the east coast of Australia, and I know that we'll just discuss.
So AJ's talked over the last few years about feelings that he has that are his own personal opinions. So we need to be distinct here in saying that he's not saying that he's prophesying this, or that he's hearing it from a spirit who's telling him this, or that God has told him. He's just saying that he has the opinion that there will be some major changes, sort of earth, what a lot of people in New Age circles would call earth changes, in the next, in the coming years, really, he has said. And a few times he said that, you know, he's felt that it might happen in, you know, in the short term. But that's always been his own opinion. And I haven't always made up...
Sorry.
So in the past few years, AJ has made some... He's spoken publicly about his opinion about some major changes that may occur, or that he believes will occur, actually, on the planet, called... Earth changes for short, if you like, but basically major changes to the geography of the planet, including earthquakes and shifts in tectonic plates, and everything that would come as a result of shifting tectonic plates, large bodies of water moving, perhaps volcanoes going off. But it's probably best to talk to him exactly about what his opinion is on that matter. Because I, for myself, haven't really resolved whether I feel it will happen or not. I feel it probably will. But because of some of the issues within my family, my dad's been talking about these kinds of changes happening for most of the last 34 years. And in a sense, because of some of the outstanding emotions I have with my dad, I don't really want to talk about them or think about them, because I feel a bit sort of over it from hearing about it from my dad. You know, I feel a bit irritated with my father about it, and about his desire to wait to change for the earth to make a change for the better in terms of love. He feels that some external events will happen and that's what will create it. And I personally think that's a bit of a cop-out, that actually if you want to change and become more loving, you'll do that from now, and the earth's geography changing is not necessarily going to inspire people to change. It perhaps may cause them to face themselves and face a lot of fears, which creates the potential for positive change, but only if people use their will in a loving direction as a result. if people choose to make choices towards further fear and violence, then it could be a very dark time on the planet. So it's probably important to say, though, that when AJ talks about these things, he's really stating his opinion. He's not saying that God has told him that these things will happen, or that a spirit has told him that these things will happen. He's just saying that his opinion at this time is that it will. And as I said, it's probably great to talk to him about the specifics of that. Does that make sense, my answer to you?
Yep.
About,
yep.
So, okay, yeah.
And I guess one, have you seen any miracles happen? And two, if AJ is Jesus, why can't he do any miracles?
So, yes, I've seen miracles happen in the first century, and I suppose it depends on what you define as a miracle. If we define a miracle as something quite extraordinary happening, that see, what I feel a miracle is when I bring myself into such a state of harmony with God's love that I can actually reflect God's love and the way that God would love others. At that point, when my will is so refined in love, God is able to, if God desires to, and I desire to, God is able to perform healings, for example, through me, or amazing changes in the environment through me. So God's energy can move through me for that period of time. So if that's how I define a miracle, I've definitely seen miracles happen in the first century through my husband. Jesus did miracles in that way. And in the spirit world, these kinds of things happen also once a person, not just Jesus, any one of us who are at one with God in terms of love, can do those kinds of things. So, yeah, so I've seen miracles happen. And at the moment, both Jesus and myself are still working through our emotions and healing to reach again this state of one with God. He attained it on earth in the first century, and I attained it after I passed into the spirit world in the first century. And we've been in that state for a long time, almost 2,000 years. But through coming back to earth, we went through a process which you could perhaps summarise as losing a connection to that level of love that's retained in our soul. And we're going through a process of releasing the injuries and errors and fears, basically, within us to allow us to again reflect God's love to that same degree. And once we do, and once anyone does, you could also engage that. We're here to teach people how to do this. And then any one of us who's reached that state of atonement with God could perform a miracle if God so wanted to, and we also wanted to. So at this point, Jesus is not back in that state, which is why he's not doing those things again.
You speak about soulmates.
Mm-hmm.
So what does it actually mean to you to have a soulmate?
When you say, what does it mean to me, I suppose I believe I have God's understanding of what soulmates are, in terms of the fact that God creates a soul. God created all of us as a complete soul. And that soul splits into two halves when we incarnate on earth, when we're conceived by our parents. Our parents create, through that process of procreation, create genetic material, which creates a physical body and a spirit body that's attached to our physical body. And then God's creation, the soul, or specifically one half of it, is attached to this physical and spirit body. And this is actually the life force, that this is what gives us life, this soul attaching to these bodies. So I'm one half of a soul, and my soulmate is the other half of that same soul. And through the process of his parents conceiving him and God's creation, his half of the soul attaching to his bodies, that's how he had life. So my soulmate is actually very literally the other half of me. And that means that we have the same nature, we have the same passions, we have the same personality, essentially, which means that we have... That is when we are in the state that God created us in and beyond in terms of love. Sadly, what happens for most of us when we are conceived and incarnate onto the planet, because our parents aren't perfectly loving, we absorb some injuries in love from them. And those injuries affect how we express our personality. So oftentimes we're walking around with a mixture of expression of our own personality and some injuries in love, in terms of, if I can maybe give an example. Say my parents are very afraid of public opinion. Then when I incarnate, I'm going to receive that from them, just from their souls and their emotional projections, that it's very important that I gain the approval of others. So if I then am born and I go about expressing my personality, I'll be very conscious of how others feel about me. And if I feel that someone in my environment is not approving of my personal expression in a certain area, then I might suppress that part of myself. So from then on, this part of my personality becomes suppressed or denied inside of myself. So very often, a lot of us are walking around not really fully expressing or experiencing our true selves. Because of that, a lot of us feel it's hard to find our soulmate. When in actual fact, if we just release these injuries from us and develop in love, and which enables us to express our personality in its most purest form, then it's very easy for us to identify who our soulmate is, because they're reflecting just, or we can feel within them just what we feel within ourselves.
So soulmate, you're one of the same, you're the same thing.
Yeah, we're two halves of the same soul.
So why is the pregnancy 9 months?
Well, just for some basic physical development reasons, in that obviously when conception occurs, there's just a tiny grouping of cells that then grow and need to develop and form all of the amazing functions so that they can perform all of the amazing functions that happen in our physical body and spirit bodies. So there is a process of actual growth that needs to occur. Did I answer your question about the 9 months? I feel like you're
yeah,
trying
because
to
it's
get
the,
at something.
No. Because it's that that's actually physical development.
Yeah.
Really.
And there's a lot of potentials that happen. Through everything that God creates, God's trying to teach us something about love. So obviously when a woman and a man conceive a child and then can feel that child growing and within the body of the mother, they can have many, many opportunities to deepen their love, to understand more about love, and to appreciate the wonder of actually what's occurring. And many pregnant women actually have that experience, don't they? Where they start to feel a bond with this growing person and feel like, wow, this is an incredible thing that's happening in my body. And God's done that so that we can have more appreciation for the process of creation of not just humans but everything around us, but also that we can begin to, we have the opportunity to understand more about how God loves us, which is in a very unconditional way, but a very intimate way, and a way that is very concerned with our personal welfare. So I see that God's creation of having a pregnancy and then a birth and giving not only the pregnancy and birth, but giving people the opportunity to be around infants and to assist them in their growth and development helps, it really opens people up from a heart perspective. And this is God trying to help us understand how much God loves us and the feelings that God has for us. God's feelings are much more intense and more pure than most people experience as they become parents. But this is just another opportunity where God's trying to show us some potentials in love that exist. Yeah.
You right, Si?
Yeah, all good, mate.
So is it possible to conceive a child in the spirit world?
No. The possibility for conception of children only occurs here on Earth. And that's actually the main purpose for procreation on Earth, is so that souls can incarnate. The main purpose for the Earth sphere, as opposed to the spirit world, is that it creates a place for people to begin to have an awareness of themselves. And when they're conceived and they begin to grow and they're born and they're infants and then they're toddlers and children and adolescents, this is all a part of God allowing us to progressively come to understand that we have our own identity and personality, and that we have our own will that we can choose to use in harmony with love or in disharmony with love. And when we use it in harmony with love, there's positive consequences, and in disharmony with love, there's negative consequences. But this earth plane is really the, AJ likes to call it the nursery of the soul. It's the place where we begin to understand our soul and the potentials for our soul. So... So the purpose of our having this physical existence here on Earth is that it's actually quite a gentle way that God is beginning to show us that we have a will that we can use in harmony with love, and when we do, it has positive consequences, and that we can also use that will in disharmony with love, and when we do, it has negative consequences. And the whole of Earth is designed to give us, to start to give us this feedback system that we are an individual who can make choices.
To make choices, that is a cut point there anyway. So I think well, that's interesting. I'm pleased I asked that question.
When I finished high school and I was considering what career to take on, I knew that I wanted to do something to help others. And I wanted to help people to make their lives happier and better. And I also had a lot of concern for the fact that there was a lot of people in my own society, but also around the world, that had far less opportunities than myself, who had far poorer quality of life than I did. And I've always felt really passionate about helping those people. So I entered a profession called occupational therapy, which is a lot about helping people to gain independence and or maintain their independence, helping people with quality of life issues, helping people to explore the roles in their life and what brings them joy, what brings them fulfillment, and assisting them in whatever way that I could. So I did that job for about, I studied at university and I went off and worked in that profession for about 8 or 10 years. At that point I felt, I worked with various clients in various communities, but I still had this really deep yearning to do stuff for people who I could. I'd travelled quite a lot and I'd seen people living in the developing world, and I really felt passionate about wanting to assist some of these people. So through a program called Australian Volunteers International, myself and my partner at the time volunteered to go and live and work in a refugee camp for 2 years in Beirut, Lebanon.
Okay. Yep, we got Beirut, Lebanon. Did you get that though?
Yeah, got that.
Okay.
This was a just a wonderful experience for me. It wasn't without trials or without my own feelings. At times I felt really inadequate within that role. But I felt also very privileged to be welcomed into this community where people have been struggling for a long time. There's a lot of issues in the Palestinian community worldwide where they've been displaced for a long time, over 50 years, and are still living without passports and without human rights and a lot of recognised human rights by world governments. So it was a very powerful experience for me, and I felt very impassioned about continuing in that career, actually. I began to study a master's degree. I had my undergraduate degree in occupational therapy, and I began a master's degree in international aid and development. And I moved to Scotland for a time where I did voluntary work with refugees and asylum seekers as I continued my study, and I worked in the community there as an occupational therapist also. About that time, not long after that, I began to feel that something was still missing. There was still a way, there still seemed to be so many limitations in terms of how to reach people, how to really bring effective change in people's lives. And it was probably with that that feeling of still needing to keep looking, keep my eye out for what more, what was the missing part, that I returned to Australia after about 5 years of living abroad. And very soon after that, I met Jesus again, or AJ as it's called now, and that was really powerful in that it didn't happen in an instant. I didn't say, oh yes, I've found the answer. In fact, I went through quite a bit of struggle with just the impact of what divine truth means on an interpersonal level and in practical application on a worldwide level. But I certainly believe it is the answer to ending world poverty, violence, the terrible plight of women in a lot of developing countries. I believe that divine truth in practical application in the lives of individuals and broader communities is the thing that will change our world. But it doesn't. Divine truth, by definition, cannot be enforced upon people. It has to be embraced willingly by individuals and communities and governments. And so it was both a really, really beautiful understanding and or recognition that I allowed myself to feel, but it's also I'm aware that it's very dependent upon everyone else desiring the same thing I do, which is to change the world in a really positive and beautiful way.
Is Jesus perfect?
No. At this point, Jesus is not perfect. And it depends also on what you define as perfect. I see perfection as someone who is loving all of the time. And Jesus is nearly perfect under that definition. By his own admission, he's still working through issues of fear that prevent him being loving 100% of the time and reflecting love in the way that God would love 100% of the time. Because what we're both engaged in is developing a relationship with God that helps us, that enables us to receive God's love and then to refine our personal love that's inside of us to come into harmony with the way that God loves. So Jesus has been re-engaged in that process now for probably nearly a decade, and he's a very sincere man, and so because of that he is very nearly perfect under my first definition. But there's still some issues that he's working through in terms of being able to love the way that God loves 100% of the time. But a lot of people expect Jesus to be perfect in terms of his diction, in terms of his... they expect him to be able to prophesy the future. They expect him to be able to read their mind and know everything about them 100% of the time. And I don't see those things as issues of perfection. They're issues of knowledge. Sometimes they're issues of powers of mediumship. They're not. For me, perfection is someone who is able to love all of the time as God loves. And in the first century, Jesus was perfect in that way. And in fact, for most of the time that I've known him, he's been perfect in that way. It's only in the last 50 years that he has very humbly decided to engage in this experiment that we're in in the full knowledge that that would mean losing that state of perfection in terms of the way that God loves, so that his life, and I also made the same life, so that the same decision, so that my life could become an example to others of how we can move from a place of having fear within us, having pain within us, releasing that pain and moving into a state again where we can love in the way that God loves 100% of the time.
I just thought of it. So what language is spoken in the spirit world?
The language that is spoken in the higher spheres of the spirit world is not verbal. It's all based around feelings. In fact, it's possible for me to convey a huge chunk of information to you, if we were both in a high condition of love in the spirit world, just through transmitting a feeling towards you, and you would understand what I wanted, what I wanted to let you know about, where we were going to go for lunch today, or all these things can happen on a soul level, is what I call it. So I'm communicating not with my mind or my voice, but a soul-to-soul exchange. In most of the lower spheres of the spirit world, where people aren't as open to their soul, they're still able to communicate without a formalized language like English or French, and by conveying thoughts, if you like, thoughts to the other person, sort of like telepathy as we would understand it on Earth perhaps. But that's possible to be done without language either, just as a it requires some development on the part of the receiver, and a lot of times people do use their common language, and it requires you knowing the same language to receive. But it is possible on some occasions to, like, almost... It sounds... I know this all sounds very science fiction, but to almost, like, translate your thoughts, to understand them.
So is it possible for you and AJ to do that now that when you've come back to Earth now?
Well, it requires that we're both very open to our soul. And for myself, I'm not as open to our soul as AJ is right now. I still have more fears within me, more anger within me that prevents me just opening up fully to who I am. So it is possible, and very often he feels my feelings very rapidly. Sometimes before I want to acknowledge them, he can already feel what's going on for me. So he does communicate in that way with most people already. And that's one of the beautiful things, that as we open up to our soul and our own personal feelings, we become very sensitive to the soul and the feelings of other people around us. So AJ does communicate in that way a lot. And he attempts to communicate back to, you know, he can feel me and feel... And I could even sit here now and send him, like, what I feel, and he would receive that and know what's going on for me. But I'm not, because I actually have a lot of fear of love inside of me at the moment, often his feelings for me are very loving and very beautiful, and sometimes I want to shut that down, sadly. Still.
Can you explain to me that, say, sceptics would say that you have all these memories which are really clear and vivid?
Mm-hmm.
And you can't speak the language, your sort of native tongue way.
Sure. So the question is really about the fact that I can remember my first century life in quite a lot of detail. It's very vivid and emotional for me, but I can't actually speak Aramaic or Hebrew.
That is the question, yes. Yeah. You said it again.
You got it in.
Sure?
You got it in, yeah.
Are you sure there's not a little bit of... Because I find that
it
hard to cut.
Okay. Yeah. So do you want me to
say... No, there was a pause. I think you paused, didn't you? And then it started.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. It was one of the ones that I thought was...
Okay.
So this question. I'd like... There's a long-winded way of explaining this to you, which I should probably do. The reason I can't speak those languages is that I'm in connection, or I'm yeah, I'm in connection. My memories are stored within my soul. My soul doesn't have a mind or a brain. It's a soul, and when it's attached now to this physical body and this spirit body, I'm using this brain and the mind that's in my spirit body in harmony with my soul, or in communication with my soul. But that sounds like it's a little bit disjointed, when actually it's all happening simultaneously and seamlessly together. But my understanding of language is stored within my brain and my mind. My memories of language are stored within my brain and my mind. The soul, if you like, is the receptacle for all of my passions and desires. My memories, in terms of the emotions that I felt, the fear that I had, the excitement that I had, the joy that I had, that's how memories are retained in the soul, in the language of emotion, if you like. And so, because I don't have the same brain or the same mind or the same physical body, if you like, and the same spirit body as I had in the first century, I don't retain the memory of those languages. But the memory of the events, in terms of what happened, how they happened, and how I felt during them, this is clear, vivid, as if it happened to me in the last 35 years with this same physical body. You know, the common things that people accuse AJ of are somehow controlling me. And the implication I feel in that accusation is that I don't really have a brain of my own, or that I'm somehow open to control because of something I'm avoiding within myself. And basically, the way we live our life is not to avoid anything within ourselves. So it's very difficult to control me through an emotional injury or a fear or a sense of lack inside of myself or neediness inside of myself, because the whole principles of what we teach, and certainly AJ's encouragement towards me, is always to deal with those issues straight on. Don't avoid fear, don't deny pain, always challenge neediness by taking responsibility for personal emotions. So the implication that somehow he's controlling me through some emotional manipulation, it doesn't really have any logical grounding. And certainly now even I teach people how to do these things. So, and also I believe if people were to examine even my presence on our videos of seminars over the last 5 years, I believe it's possible to see some development in my character in terms of confidence and happiness and willingness to share with others and be myself more. And I've got out more. And
you did. Very well done. You've got a good habit for this.
So hang on, there's a lot to say about this probably that would be nice to cover. So I said the thing about control. Do you have any question about that?
No.
I suppose the other thing that people often imply is that because I'm younger in years or in this life than AJ, of course we don't consider ourselves to have much of an age difference, because we've spent a long time together in the spirit world and as equals, and we feel we've had a very long life before this incarnation here as Mary Luck and Alan John Miller. But Alan John Miller was born some 15 or 16 years before I was. And so sometimes people make the quiet implication that AJ is only with me because I'm younger than him, and that they perceive that I'm quite a pretty person, and that would be why he's with me, for the sex with the young woman. And that's kind of a little bit funny, because as I've been very open and frank with people about over the years, when I met AJ, I wasn't really that excited about him saying to other people who he was, saying to people that he was Jesus, or the idea that I was going to need to come to terms with the fact, emotionally and psychologically, that all of my memories that I'd had before then actually meant that I am Mary Magdalene. So I became very angry, I was quite resistive, I told him on any number of occasions that I didn't want to be with him, we split up, we got back together, I told him I wasn't attracted to him, and I really at that time felt that until I dealt with some fear, and then I thought, oh my gosh, I'm so attracted to you, and really it hasn't been an idyllic situation for AJ in our romantic relationship for a long time. And even now, because both of us, and especially him, we really want to have a relationship that's based around love, not neediness, not one person controlling the other, not a sense of emotional addiction with each other or codependence, then especially he, and growing within myself, we have this desire to confront any time when there might be an issue where one person is being codependent on the other. And certainly for myself, in terms of sex, I've had a lot of issues to work through, and I'm still working through a lot of issues. And because of that, at times AJ has said, look, I think it's best you need to work through this stuff, that we don't even sleep together until you work through it. And so I sleep at the house and he sleeps in the tent as I'm working through different issues. For sometimes that's happened up to 6 months at a time. So it's kind of a crazy idea to think that AJ's with this younger woman because it's all about the sex holiday that he's having. It's also, I find it a really, I'm laughing about it, but it's a horrible implication about his character, because anyone, if they were to know him as I know him, they would see that he is so full of integrity, fidelity, sincerity. His viewpoint of our relationship is one that he honours me as much as he honours himself and his own desires. And he won't even let me try to do something that is based in an addictive desire to get approval and deny myself. He's more interested in me. And I find those kind of comments are kind of a very underhanded way of undermining his character, and to a great degree undermining mine. It's the implication is that I'm not perhaps very smart, and I'm just with some guy to get some, I don't know, that I'm not thinking or I'm not feeling, and that I'm not taking responsibility for my own life and my own decisions.
Excellent. So you had memories of AJ as a child?
Sure. One of the really interesting things for me as I open up more emotionally is feeling this knowledge that I've known AJ while I've been in the spirit world and he was on Earth. So because I was born, perhaps a better way to answer the question is, because I was born 16 years after AJ was born again on the Earth, I spent a lot of time with him in his early childhood. And even looking at old photographs of him now, I know where that was, and I remember being with him and how he was at those different times in his life. And that's because I was actually able to be with him in a spirit form while he was experiencing life here again on Earth. And we spent a lot of time together in that way until I then reincarnated. And then there was quite a deep sense of separation for me, and a lot of sadness to be separate from him. Obviously, as soulmates and as soulmates who've experienced a reunion of our soul, when God creates our soul, it's in a unified state, and then it splits when we incarnate on Earth the first time. The process that he and I went through after we passed in the first century was to grow ourselves in God's love so much that we were able to reunite our soul. So we experienced a very deep state of union. And we had to, if you like, create a separation from that union to come back to Earth again. And so when finally I reincarnated, or was on Earth a second time. It was like a complete loss of any connection with that feeling, and that's quite a devastating feeling for me now to go through and experience and release. Both AJ and I really dislike having any kind of shorthand in the way that we speak, but obviously when we've been speaking to people over a period of time, you sort of start to feel like you have a sense of what I'm talking about. But even in seminars, we hate abbreviating anything, or we really like to explain things because so much meaning gets lost when you change words.
So, when did you first meet AJ?
I met AJ in my parents' living room. I'd just come back from living overseas for about 5 years, and they had been listening to him speak for a period of, I'm not sure how long actually, because I wasn't living in the country, but I would say at least a year they'd been attending small talks that he was giving in people's homes, and they actually started to host some in their own home. So what that meant was just that AJ would show up, sometimes with a whiteboard, sit in their downstairs living room, and maybe 20 people, 30 people would come and listen to him talk about a topic of pertaining to God or love, similar to the seminars that we now give to much larger groups, but it was a little bit more informal. So my parents had been listening to AJ speak for some time, and they said they were pleased that I was coming home because I would get to hear what this fellow that they'd been listening to, who reckoned he was Jesus and they weren't sure about that, what he had to say. So that's how I met AJ, and at the time I was quite preoccupied with myself and different things that were going on in my life. I'd just broken up from a relationship with another man, so I certainly wasn't looking for another romantic attachment. I also was considering what to do, what was the next step in my career, where did I want to live, did I want to return to living overseas, or did I want to stay in Australia for a while. And so I sort of attended the talk a little bit distracted, I suppose. And meeting him, I wish I could tell you that meeting him was like a sudden starry-eyed meeting across the room and I had an amazing recognition. That didn't happen. I just felt very drawn to him. In a way, I just felt I wanted to know him more. And I desperately sort of wanted him to want to know me. But he appeared to be very reserved with me and he didn't say very much. And I learnt later that he sort of had quite a moment when he met me, and he felt immediately who I was, but he didn't want to distress me or perturb me with any of that knowledge. He felt that anyone of the 14 who've returned to Earth really need to come to that understanding for themselves, and also that he was quite sensitive too. He could feel there was a lot of other emotional turmoil going on inside of me. And also he tells me he felt quite shy and tongue-tied and nervous about himself. He felt a bit like a teenager. So we didn't speak much at that first meeting. And we met a couple of times in similar circumstances. He gave another talk. But after time, he left to go on an overseas trip. And about a month or so later, my parents sat me down and said to me, look, we just feel there's something that we need to tell you that we found out from someone else who told us that AJ Miller believes that you're his soulmate. Now, I had a very strange reaction. The first words out of my mouth were, I knew it. And then I immediately thought, I don't know that. What am I saying? That seems very... What do I know? It was a very strange moment. And my parents just said, well, we thought, you know, we knew this, that you should probably know, and, you know, if you ever want to talk about it, whatever, and just moved on with whatever the next thing was that they wanted to talk about. But for me, something very large began to happen in my soul. I didn't have any contact with AJ. I didn't speak with him for weeks afterwards. But it was as if something inside of me was saying, you need to pay attention to this. I didn't feel romantically attracted to him. I certainly didn't want to be with a guy who was saying that he was Jesus. I didn't even really think that I had a strong feeling about what a soulmate was, except that I seemed to suddenly start to have these really strong feelings about that. And for a number of weeks, I couldn't really attend to much else except this sort of strange feeling that was happening inside of me. I wasn't distressed, but it was as if something inside of me was saying, this is the thing you need to pay attention to. This is it almost. And my rational mind kept going, what? What is it? I don't get this. And so eventually after time, I wrote AJ an email and I said, look, it was a very brief and direct email. I wasn't giving anything away. I just said, hi, I've heard that you think we're soulmates. I would like to hear what you have to say about that. I may or may not have my own feelings about that, but I don't really want to talk to you about that. I'll wait to hear from you. So very brief, very direct. And he wrote back to me a very beautiful email, which was very non-pressuring and very just saying, since you asked, this is what I feel, but I feel that it's up to you. You need to have your own feelings and there's no pressure from my end. And so over a period of months, we formed a relationship, and eventually I went overseas to join him on his overseas trip. And once I got there, actually, the part of me that was still trying to say, this is a little ridiculous, because your rational mind does try to do that, because a very strange sensation is happening inside of you, and this man is saying that he's Jesus, and you do think that, you know, your rational mind is going, well, everyone's going to think you're nuts, and also, really? That's the kind of feeling. And I thought, it would be much better, you know, even if it's true, if he would just stop talking about it, you know, just stop telling people, because it's really not going to work out well. So this is sort of the arrogant feeling I hopped on the plane with. And when I got there, we spent some time together, and I actually became quite emotional quite quickly. And I had a recognition of him as Jesus. I remembered events from our life. And I very quickly felt that it was scaring me so much that I wanted to shut the entire process down. And we went from sort of perhaps a budding relationship to me actually becoming quite angry. I couldn't really rationalize why I was angry. I was just terrified and I didn't want to feel it. So we actually came back from the trip, and I don't know if you could say we broke up, because I'm not sure we were actually ever together, but we went our separate ways. And for a number of months, I just tried very hard to shut down this knowledge that had been confirmed inside of me that it was all true. And my parents also, during this overseas trip, they'd always said that they were very open to me having my own experience and my own beliefs. But I realised that I'd always had the same beliefs as them, really. They'd always said they're fine if I didn't, but I had actually always just had the same beliefs as them. And my decision to go on this trip with AJ sparked a lot of fear, certainly inside of my mother. She told me she was quite afraid of what others would think about this and what changes I might undergo. And during the trip, both of my parents became more and more negative. They didn't want to hear about my experience or what was happening for me. And they actually started to become, the feelings coming from them were very disapproving. By the time I got home, they had decided, from going from having AJ stay in their home quite regularly, by the time I got home, they had decided that AJ was a bad man, based on no other experience except that I had started to have a relationship with him. And so when we went our separate ways, they were quite happy about that. Now, I felt very sad. I was so emotionally confused because I so desperately wanted my parents' approval, but I also felt so incredibly drawn to AJ, and again, not in a romantic way, just in this way that I need to discover truth here. So my parents sort of were placated for a couple of months until I got to the point where I thought, I need to resolve this for myself. Regardless of my relationship with AJ or my parents, I need to know what is the truth about me. And at that point, my parents began to become very abusive, verbally abusive about AJ to me and about the teachings of divine truth. And I was saying to them, look, I don't mind if you don't agree, but I need to explore this. And I actually believe certainly these teachings are very true. And they just became more and more aggressive with me to the point where they, were swearing, yelling at me on the phone, threatening AJ with physical violence. And at that point I said, look, that's enough. I don't feel that anyone should have to receive that kind of treatment from anyone else, regardless of who they are. And until you guys are able to treat us with respect for our differing viewpoints — we certainly have respect for the fact that you don't share our viewpoints — but until that time, I can't be in your life. And so that was a very sad time for me. I felt that my whole life concept, my whole family concept, completely disintegrated, and I was quite attached to it. So I had to go through a lot of grief, a lot of crying about the fact that my parents were behaving in a way that was shocking me. I never thought that they would behave in that way. I'd never seen them behave in that way before. And I felt a huge amount of pressure brought to bear upon me to change what I was doing, to change my journey of self-exploration in order to please them. And that made me feel very sad. It made me feel that they cared more about their well-being than my own. And so I went through years, really, of grief about that. At times I was angry and I had to let myself feel that. And then feeling a lot of fear about how others, because my parents, who I thought I was closest to in the world, were treating me in this way by exploring the possibility that, that I want to have this life and teach these things, because the people I thought I was closest to in the world started treating me in that way, I became terrified of telling anyone about it, because I felt, if my parents are doing this to me, how's everyone else going to react? And I went into a lot of fear. And then I had to grieve that, hey, I had to let go. I had to let go of having people's approval all the time. And in a way, I'm still going through that. I'm still needing to grieve and let go of this feeling that I really want people to like me. So I think it's important to say that before I met AJ, I'd had a number of very intense emotional experiences that were in fact memories, but I shut them down very heavily.
Explain to me what they were.
Okay. So I'd at the age of 15, I was in a workshop, and I had very suddenly, I was sitting with my eyes closed, I listened to a piece of music, and I suddenly had the deep sense that I had lost something very dear to me, a person very dear to me, a life very dear to me, a relationship with God, except I was so afraid of the idea of God at the age of 15. I couldn't really understand what I was feeling the loss of. It overwhelmed me, and I was sobbing for a number of hours, much to the, people around me were a little bit worried, especially because I couldn't really explain what I was sad about, except in the way that I've just explained it to you, except probably even in a more incoherent way than I just explained it to you. So I'd had a number of experiences similar to that, where a sudden emotional knowledge had come upon me. And look, it is very difficult to explain this to you in a way that I feel is adequate with language, because memory is not just emotion. But I don't know actually how to explain memory. I just had a memory. For example, in my early 20s, I had the memory that I had been raped and physically harmed by men. And at that time, I had no context for that. That had not happened to me in the previous 20 years, or nor has it happened since. And I couldn't understand it. I thought, this is bizarre. And so I just sort of tried to shut down that experience, because when you start to have a bizarre experience that you don't really understand and it's very emotional, you just think, well, I don't know, I'll just move on. Let's distract myself, or try to suppress it in whatever way I can. And I actually drank a lot of alcohol in my 20s in an attempt to just drown out any kind of these intense sorrows that would arise in me that seemed to be attached to events that hadn't happened before. So all of that was sort of happening, but I was trying desperately to suppress it before I met AJ. At that time, I had no concept that actually feeling emotion enables it to release and be dissipated. I now understand that very well, but at that time I had no idea. And so I thought, well, I'm distressed and I don't want to be, so I've just got to suppress it and get on and distract myself.
Thinking about the next question, but
meeting AJ suddenly gave a context to all of these things. Do you understand what I mean by context? It suddenly gave a possible reason for these intense experiences that I'd had before. But I didn't like that reason. I didn't like that answer. I said to him, we didn't actually discuss the intense memories that I'd had before. And in fact, I put such a limitation on him when I met him that I said, I do not want you to tell me anything about what you remember in the first century. I don't want to be coloured by any sort of suggestion from anyone or anywhere. If I'm going to have an experience, it's going to be my own. And so he respected that very much. We didn't discuss memories, we didn't discuss experiences, we didn't even discuss what it was like for him to have a memory. Just tell me if it's making sense, because it is so hard to explain this stuff.
Yeah.
And it's also really hard to explain things from the point of view of people are quite critical, you know, trying to think of how you can answer a critic. It's like a horrible way to think.
Yes, yes. Where some people think, right, okay, so one Saturday afternoon you both sat down and you both said, right, okay, you're going to be Mary Magdalene, or you're going to be I'm Jesus.
Yeah, it's nothing like that happened. I'm sort of answering that. Yeah, okay, that's good. Yeah. And this is what, and he, I met him and he went, oh, you had this happen, this happened, this happened. Like the majority of the memories that I have of the first century, like we were only together on Earth for 2 years. The majority of my life is my life. You know, before I met him, after he passed, I have full memories of all of that also. And he wasn't there for the first part of my life. Yeah. Where was I up to?
Sorry, I was concentrating on exposure.
Okay. I put a limitation on him.
Yes, so you didn't want any memories. You didn't want that. Your memories wanted to be your own rather than...
And I wouldn't allow him to discuss anything about what he had experienced as memories or what he felt my life was like in the first century. And he respected that very much. And so it was only over, and I'm talking years here, that I began to open up more and share more of what I remembered. And actually we found that our memories correlate. You know, my memories of being with him, he remembers the same events or when we were together. We have shared memories, if you like, but it took a long time for me to even want to talk to him about that, because it's funny when people say that I'm somehow controlled or he's convinced me, because I'm very kind of a tenacious person, and I want to be sure of things that I'm sure of. And if there's room for doubt, I want to explore that doubt. And if there's room for suggestion, I want to make sure that that suggestion hasn't happened. So I went into it really probably in a very controlling manner, but it was in a way that I felt I wanted to have my own experience, to know my own mind. And I certainly do know my own mind, and I do have my own experience even now.
And then maybe just a short version, just like a little soundbite. So I guess it's also to the point as well. So did AJ tell you that you are Mary Magdalene?
AJ has never told me that I'm Mary Magdalene. I came to that conclusion myself. I knew at some point that he felt that I was Mary Magdalene, but he never told me that I was. And he's never made it a condition of him loving me or knowing me that I should accept that I'm Mary Magdalene.
Excellent. Yeah.